So I'm going to talk about non-productive topological strings. And this is mostly started with this paper with Alba Grasso, with a postdoc here, and my postdoc just in here 2 years ago. So this led to many developments. And today, what I want to do is to explain how these developments. So what I want to do today is to explain you how this work that we did gives a non-perturbative definition of topological strings. And what I want also to explain, if time permits, is how this is related to resurgence. And this is work in progress with Ricardo Couso Santa Maria and Ricardo Schiappa. Okay, so let me give you the sharp problem that we would like to solve. So as you probably know very well, string theory, and in particular topological string theory, is defined by a formal diverging expansion. So this means that if you take all the genus G free energies, say of topological string theory, this is an object that featured yesterday in Albrecht's talk, and you sum them over all genera with appropriate couplings of the string coupling, with appropriate powers of the string coupling constant, this thing is just a formal series. It doesn't make sense. You just put numerical values for T and for G, you just get infinity. And the reason is that these FGs grow factorially with the genera, okay? And this is actually something which is very common in quantum theory, which is that perturbative theories typically are divergent, are not convergent, are asymptotic and divergent, and you don't know how to make sense of a total sum over genera in this case. So the question we want to ask is the following. Is there a well-defined and computable function of the moduli and the string coupling constant which leads to this expansion as an asymptotic expansion? And this is the problem of formulating string theory, topological string theory, non-perturbative. So what you want to do is to actually interpret this formal series, which doesn't make sense by itself, as the asymptotic series of something well-defined. And it's very important that this something is well-defined, because if you end up giving me something which is not well-defined, then it's not really worth the effort, because the series was not well-defined to start with. So you have to give me something which is manifestly well-defined. And this is the problem of formulating topological string theory non-perturbative. So the expression non-perturbative topological string has been used a lot in recent years, has been abused a lot in recent years. So I want to actually explain what I mean by this by going back to basics. So let me explain what I mean by a non-perturbative completion by going back to quantum mechanics. So imagine that you take a Hamiltonian of the quartic oscillator. So you have the standard harmonic oscillator, and you perturb it with a quartic term. So this Hamiltonian is no longer exactly solvable. And what you can try to do is to compute, for example, the energy of the ground state as a power series in this coupling constant G. Okay? So there is a well-known procedure, a formal procedure to do it. And you can push this computation quite far if you want. And what you obtain in this way is, again, a formal power series in G. So these are the first terms. This 1/2 is the energy of the ground state of the harmonic oscillator. And then you have a formal power series in G. This formal power series is again divergent, is factorial. The coefficients diverge like n factorial. So again, this series is like the series of the string theory in the sense that it doesn't make sense. It's a factorial series, it's a formal series. You cannot put g equal to one number and get a number out of it. Okay? So how do you define the non-perturbative problem for this elementary example? Well, you want to have a non-perturbative completion of this perturbative series, you have to use a non-perturbative definition which is provided by the spectral theory of Schrödinger operators. This is what you need in this case. So what you have to do is to consider the Hamiltonian as an operator on the Hilbert space L2R, and you have to prove two theorems in order to give this non-perturbative definition. The first theorem states that this operator, H inverse of H, the inverse of the Hamiltonian, is a compact operator. It's actually a trace class operator for all positive values of G. So this is a theorem you can find, for example, in the book by Berezin and Subin. It's a proof. It takes actually a few pages. And then once you have this theorem proved, you know that this Hamiltonian has a discrete and well-defined spectrum. And the lowest value of this spectrum is the ground state energy, which is then a well-defined function of G. So that's the first thing. So you see, in order to have an operative definition, you have to typically prove a theorem. It's not just enough to make some construction. You have to really, because you want to have something well-defined, so you better have some theorem proof. Now, the second theorem tells you that this function that you define through spectral theory has an asymptotic expansion, and that this asymptotic expansion agrees with the expansion that you find in perturbation theory. Okay? So this is how you do well done, so you do a well, you have a well-defined non-perturbative compression of an asymptotic series. And of course, you want this quantity not to be a mystical object, but to be something computable. So what you found in this way, through this non-perturbative definition, this object that you define through through spectral theory, has to be computable. And actually, it can be computed, for example, by using numerical diagonalization. Now I put g equal to 1 and I get a number, something that I cannot do if you give me just the asymptotic series. If I put g equal 1 in the asymptotic series, I get infinity. Here I get a number. So this is what I mean by a good non-perturbative definition. So this is the standard definition that you would get in quantum mechanics. Now, there are more complicated examples in the sense that you can have now problems with two coupling constants, not just with one coupling constant. And this is typical, the typical case in ADS-CFT. Now, in ADS-CFT, you say that you define non-perturbatively a string theory through a gauge theory. So in the standard case, you have, again, a genus expansion, say for the free energy of a string theory, of a superstring theory. This depends on some radius or length scale of the background of the theory. So for example, in ADS, this is typically L over LS to the fourth, where L is the ADS radius and LS is the string length. Then you have the standard genus expansion, and you say that this object, which is again divergent and ill-defined and so on, is the syntactic expansion of a gauge theory of free energy, which depends on N and GS, and lambda is going to be related to N and GS through the standard relationship that you find in ADS-CFT. So this lambda is going to be identified with the top coupling of the gauge theory. Now, see, this is again an asymptotic expansion, and this defines the superstring perturbation series as the asymptotic series of a well-defined object. Now, there is here a small subtlety, which is a some sort of mismatch of the ranges of the variables involved. And the mismatch is due to the fact that n here is a positive integer. So you have a positive integer and a real number, while here you just have two real numbers, lambda and GS. So it's clear that you cannot cover all the range of lambda and GS by using a positive integer and GS. So in a sense, it seems like the non-perturbative definition, which is given by gauge theory, covers less space than the standard superstring perturbation theory. So sometimes people say, well, but you know, when n is very large, it's almost like it was continuous, blah, blah, blah. Okay, that's nice, but we need sometimes more precise statements about what we mean here by a non-perturbative definition, because we would like actually to extend the right-hand side to a full function of n for any value of n. And this is something that I will comment on it later. So, but you know, just keep in mind when you do non-perturbative completions through ADS-CFT that one of the variables in the non-perturbative definition is intrinsically quantized, because it's the rank of the gauge group. So this leads to some subtleties that have to be addressed. Okay. So let me again give you, after this discussion, the definition of a non-perturbative definition. So a non-perturbative definition of a formal perturbative series is a well-defined function, which is computable of the relevant parameters, at least in some range. So at least in some range, we want this function to be well-defined and computable. And this function has to lead as an asymptotic expansion to the original perturbative series and nothing else. You cannot have the perturbative series plus other perturbative series, because then you have more stuff than you used to have. Now, in the case of topological strings on toric Calabi-Yau's, there have been some non-perturbative definitions in the literature, but I claim, and this is maybe a little bit polemical, that none of these definitions satisfies this criterion and applies to all toric Calabi-Yau's simultaneously. Maybe I'm wrong, but if I'm wrong, I'm very happy to discuss it. So there are some definitions, for example, like large N type definitions, like Gopakumar-Bafa, which actually satisfy this criteria. They are actually very good in the sense of ADS-CFT, but they only apply to a discrete family of Calabi-Yau's. You have resolved conifold, AN vibrations over P1, but it doesn't apply to all of them. And then you have other definitions, in quotation marks, which actually do not satisfy this criterion. For example, definitions based on OSV, which express the result in terms, at the end of the day, you can express the non-perturbative definition in terms of QD Fornier Mills, do not satisfy this definition because the asymptotic expansion just doesn't lead just to the original perturbative series. There are some extra stuff that you have to remove by hand. And then, you know, they are not really non-perturbative definitions in the sense that I'm using here in the standard sense. So what I'm going to do in this talk is to provide you a definition, non-perturbative definition of topological strings on general toric Calabi-Yau manifolds. So let me review a little bit what is the main setting. So the tonic Calabi-Yau's are essentially the simplest but non-trivial Calabi-Yau threefolds that you can have, and they are all non-compact. Now, one technical way of giving you a toric Calabi-Yau is by giving you a Newton polygon. And in this case, if you are given this Newton polygon, you can construct the mirror manifold to the Calabi-Yau by just computing the Newton polynomial of the polygon. And a very important aspect of toric Calabi-Yau is that their mirrors are just algebraic curves. After, you know, in general, as Albrecht was explaining yesterday, you have a mirror of a Calabi-Yau threefold, it's going to be another threefold, but in local cases, it turns out that this threefold reduces essentially to an algebraic curve. And this is very crucial because it reduces the complexity of the problem enormously. So one very important example that I will use in this talk as an example to provide you with concrete details of the theory is local P2. So this is a non-compact Calabi-Yau, a toric Calabi-Yau, which is the canonical bundle over P2. And the Newton polygon in this case is given by this triangle here. So you have three extra external vertices and one internal vertices, and then you can compute the Newton polynomial of this polygon by attributing to this vertex 1, 0, e to the x, attributing to this vertex 0, 1, e to the y, and attributing to this vertex minus 1, minus 1, e to the minus x, minus y. And then this vertex, which is 0, 0, gives you just a constant kappa, which is the modulus of this toric Calabi-Yau manifold. So this is the standard equation for the mirror of the local P2, which, as you see, is an algebraic curve. It's actually an algebraic curve of genus 1, but it has the subtlety that is expressed in exponentiated variables. Okay. Now, once I give you a Calabi-Yau, toric or not, you can actually compute these topological string free energies at genus G, which usually encode what are called the Gromov-Witten invariants of this threefold. So this is a formula that I think Albrecht wrote yesterday, and restricting myself here to Calabi-Yaus which have just one Keller class, just to simplify my notation. So the genus G free energy can be computed at large radius as a sum over all possible degrees of curves in this Calabi-Yaus. The weight of such a curve is e to the minus dt, where t is the Keller parameter, and the coefficient is the Gromov-Witten invariant at genus G and degree d. Now, this is the standard definition in what we call the large radius frame. But as in Cyber-Witten theory, topological string theory and Calabi-Yau manifolds can be defined in many different frames. And this is, as I said, as it happens in Cyber-Witten theory. These frames are all equivalent perturbatively, and they are related by symplectic transformations. Actually, you can relate the free energies, the genus G free energies, in one frame to the other by using an integral transform, which was essentially based on these wave function ideas of Witten that Albrecht was explaining yesterday. But it was implemented in a very easy way in this paper by Aganagic, Bussard, and Klein. So this large radius frame of topological strings give you the Gromov-Witten invariance, but you can compute the free energies in other frames, in the same way that in Cyber-Witten theory, you can compute the free energies in the electric frame, or you can go to the monopole frame, or so-called magnetic frame, and so on. And in this talk, I will actually like to focus on a slightly different frame, which is called the magnetic frame. In this frame, which is the frame which is appropriate to analyzing the Calabi-Yau near the conifold point, the free energies have a slightly different structure. They look like as follows. First of all, they are not function of the Keller parameter, but of another period, which is called here lambda, and it's the vanishing period at the conifold point. And then they are given by a pole part, a pole of order 2g minus 2, with a known coefficient. Notice that this is actually the genus G free energy of the sequel one string. And then you have a power series in lambda, which can be computed by using different techniques. And I want to emphasize that this genus G magnetic free energy has exactly the same information as the Gromov-Witten free energies at large radius. It's just a change of symplectic frame. Now, out of these genus G free energies in the magnetic frame, I can compute again a total string theory free energy, which is going to be a sum over all different genera of this FG lambda times the string coupling constant to the power 2G minus 2. So this is the formal divergent genus expansion that I want to focus on. This is also to be divergent. These guys, FG lambdas, diverge like 2G factorial. So again, you have a formal power series, which is ill-defined. Now, if you want to start working with this power series, the first thing you have to do is to try to get as many terms as possible. For example, if you see historically how people started understanding the harmonic oscillator, the quartic oscillator I told you, a very important thing was the work of Bender and Boo. So the best on the quartic oscillator. And the first thing that Bender and Boo did in order to understand the quartic oscillator was to generate in an old computer in the end of the 60s to generate the first 70 terms of the perturbation theory for this quartic oscillator. Now it looks like a joke. This takes 3 lines in Mathematica, maybe a few seconds. But at that time it was hard, and they did it. They really look at this. They look at all these coefficients, and they started studying how they diverge and so on. So this was a very important step in understanding the non-perturbative structure of the quartic oscillator. Now, if you want to do something similar in topological string theory, the first thing you have to do is to try to generate as many FGs as you can. Okay? And actually, one person has pushed this direction very much, is Albrecht Klemm here, and thanks to his techniques, which were, by the way, based on the holomorphic animal equations of Verchaski, Cecotti, Oguri, and Baffa, you can push this calculation for the local case to very high genus. So, for example, in some of the calculations I'm going to show you today, we push this to genus 114. Okay? This, you know, to Albrecht, this is not very impressive because he can get this with 1 minute of his laptop. But it's a lot of terms. Huh? It's a lot of terms. You cannot compute as many terms in many quantum theories. Hmm? Yes? There's no
recursion at the, can they be recursively? They have a recursion property or not that FG can be given in terms of lower FG?
That's how you compute it, yeah.
And it's still hard, even though if you know the proper recursion property.
It's very hard because they are functions, they are not numbers. You see, if they were numbers, you know, that would be fast, but these are functions. So you have to use recurrence for functions, and this is another world, okay? For example, when you have functions, the recursion can involve derivatives, right? Now, and then, you know, this makes life slightly more complicated, and the recursion here involves derivatives. Okay. Now, what we want to do now is to propose a non-perturbative definition for this total free energy in this conical frame. Okay. Well, I want to find a function such that it's well-defined and that its asymptotic expansion gives exactly all this genus information. Some time ago, it was proposed that one way to get some non-perturbative definition of these theories involves quantizing the mirror curve. So the mirror curve, as I was telling you before, is this function e to the x plus e to the y, blah, 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 in many cases. You can write it very explicitly. And the idea was that you can get a non-perturbative view of quantum topological strings by quantizing this mirror curve. So let me tell you exactly how you do this, because this is not really exactly very simple. So the idea is that you take this curve that I wrote you before, this Newton polygon of the Torricalabillau, and then the variables x and y, you are going to promote it to canonically commuting Heisenberg operators. So I declare that x and y are now operators on L to R, which commute to I h bar. And h bar in this talk will be a real positive number, as in the real world. Now, for simplicity, I will focus on mirror curves of genus 1, but the theory can be extended to any genus curve. Now, if you now take this function that I was writing before here, if you try to quantize it, you will find that there are ordering issues in this term here. But there is a very natural prescription invented by Weyl already in the very beginning of quantum mechanics that tells you that you have and function like this and you have to quantize it, well, you have a minimal quantization prescription that makes this a self-adjoint operator, and this is the quantization procedure that we're going to use. We're going to use bi-quantization of these curves. And then when you do this, for local P2, you get an operator in which you just simply promote the terms that appear in the curve to operators. Okay, so you get e to the x plus e to the y plus e to the minus x minus y. And one point of the prescription is that the inner point of the Newton polygon, you don't look at it. Okay, you just remove it. Okay, you just left it behind. And the reason is because this inner point is going to actually give you the eigenvalue for this operator. So technically, just take the points which are in the boundary of the Newton polygon, but not the inner point. So this gives you an operator. And this operator, you know, has been studied, for example, by using WKB, but one natural thing you can ask is the following. What kind of operator is this, right? In quantum mechanics, we have all kinds of operators. We have operators which give you bound states. We have operators which give you scattering states. So which kind of operator is this one? Now, We actually conjecture with Alba and Yasuyuki that these operators are actually as good as they can be in spectral theory. And this was actually proved by Rinat Kasaev and myself, and also using more spectral theory techniques by Ari Laptev, Lucas Shimer, and Leon Takhtayan. And the result we found is that the inverse of this type of operators are operators on L2R which are positive definite and they are of trace class. What does it mean that they are of trace class? The fact that they are of trace class means, first of all, that they are compact. So they have a discrete spectrum. And the spectrum of this inverse of this operator, I'm going to write it as e to the minus en. Because they are positive. So these are all positive numbers, so I can always write them as exponentials. And these numbers can be computed numerically. Okay? Remember what I was telling you at the very beginning of my talk. You know, if you want to have an operator with definition, you have to have something computable. You cannot have something mystical. And then, you know, this eigenvalue Cn of this operator inverse of Ox can be computed numerically. So, for example, this is a computation when h bar is equal to 2 pi, and here they are. So this is very similar, actually. This kind of problem is very similar to a confining potential in Schrödinger theory. So in Schrödinger theory, if your potential goes to infinity, at infinity, you have only a discrete number of eigenvalues. And this is the simplest situation you can have in operator theory. Because then we know we have more complicated spectral problems, we have scattering states, or we have periodic potentials. But this is the simpler situation which you can have, where you have just a discrete set of eigenvalues, like in a confining potential in Schrödinger theory. The property that is of trace class means that the zeta functions, you want the spectral traces of this operator are all well defined. I'm going to explain this in the next transparency. So how do you encode the spectral information of a trace class operator? Well, the simplest thing you can do is to compute the spectral traces, which are, if you want, discrete analogs of the zeta function. So just take the trace of rho x to these zero shouldn't be here. Zero is not good. You have to start with one, of course. So you take a non-negative integer and you form all these sums, which are sums over the spectrum of this operator rho x. And the property that this operator is trace class means that all these traces are well defined, are finite numbers. Now, this is one way in which you can encode the spectral properties of this operator through the spectral traces, but a much more elegant way involves what is called the Fredholm determinant. When the operator is trace class, an important result of spectral theory says that you can compute this, you can define the spectral determinant as the infinite dimensional determinant of 1 plus kappa times rho x. So kappa here is a parameter that I'm going to introduce. We'll see later on that it's actually related to the kappa parameter that appears in the spectral curve. It's actually the modulus of the spectral curve. And this determinant can be written in many ways. There are various theorems. One theorem expresses as some sort of exponential of combination of these spectral traces. But one very important theorem in spectral theory tells me that the Fredholm determinant of a trace class operator is an entire function of kappa. So this guy turns out to be an entire function of kappa, and in particular I can expand this around the origin. And when I expand this function around the origin, I get coefficients which depend on h bar and on n. And this object is going to be very important in our talk. I'm going to call it fermionic spectral trace. It's a natural object that appears in spectral theory, and notice that through this identity you can compute all these fermionic spectral traces from the standard spectral traces that I define here. Okay? So these are kind of basic ingredients of spectral theory. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with spectral theory or who do not feel very comfortable with this, there is a much more physical way of thinking about this, which is the following. Think about rho as a density matrix, okay? A density matrix of a quantum system, and let's imagine that this is the spectrum of this density matrix. Now, in this picture, this Fredholm determinant is what you call the grand canonical partition function of an ensemble of fermions with fugacity kappa. Okay? So kappa is the fugacity of a Fermi gas, and this is interpreted as the grand canonical partition function. And then these fermionic spectral traces are the canonical partition functions for a gas of n fermions with that density matrix rho. Okay? So that's why I call it fermionic spectral traces, because they are the canonical partition functions of an ensemble of n fermions. So this is the canonical ensemble, and this is the grand canonical ensemble. Okay? So you can reinterpret all these notions of spectral theory in terms of gases, of free Fermi gases. Okay. So here there is only this is the density matrix, the one particle density matrix. So these are like fermions in a single potential with these energy levels. Huh? And then you fill the energy levels using the exclusion principle, and then you get these thermodynamic quantities. Okay, so these fermionic spectral traces are well defined. And they are well defined because I was very careful in checking that these operators are of trace class. And they can compute it from first principles in the quantum mechanical model. For example, if n is equal to 1, I can compute this number as the integral of the kernel of this operator rho x, of the diagonal kernel. Okay, this is an elementary formula that follows from the formula that I was showing you before. And this integral converges precisely because rho is of trace class. Now, it turns out that for these operators that come from mirror curves, all these operators, the integral kernels, the kernels of these operators, can be written explicitly for many geometries. And then they involve what is called the Fadejev quantum dilogarithm. And this was shown in a paper by Kasayev and myself. And actually, this means that you can very often compute these numbers analytically. And this is a rare luxury in quantum mechanics. If I give you a generic confining potential in quantum mechanics and I ask you to compute the spectral trace, you will have a hard time because it's not so easy to find these integral kernels explicitly. For example, André Bogos computed some time ago the first spectral trace for the quartic oscillator. Okay? So he actually managed to compute this, but already the second spectral trace, when n is equal to 2, it's very, very hard to compute. Well, in this case, sometimes we can compute this to very high order, and actually there was a paper by Masahito and my former student Pavel Putro where they did a similar computation in a similar context, and they were able to get many of these fermionic spectral traces explicitly. So this is a rare luxury in quantum mechanics. And what is remarkable, in a sense, one remarkable spin-off of this theory that I'm presenting you here, is that these operators are much, much simpler than any operator that you find in Schrödinger's theory. These operators are such that you can very often write down explicit quantization conditions, explicit formula for the Fredholm determinants, and things that you cannot even dream of in Schrödinger's theory. So in a sense, exponentiating the Heisenberg variables leads to an spectral theory which is much nicer than the usual spectral theory in which you use x and p. Okay? So you have to take e to the x and e to the p, and then suddenly these operators become much more manageable than the standard operators that you find in quantum mechanics. And one of the nice things that you can do with all this theory is actually write down explicit expressions, for example, for the eigenfunctions of these operators and for the spectrum, which are really very, very hard to find in any non-trivial confining quantum potential in quantum mechanics, except, of course, for the harmonic oscillator. Okay, as I said, these things can be computed very explicitly in some cases, and the quantum theory is particularly simple when h bar is equal to 2 pi. More generally, when h bar is a rational multiple of pi, this theory can be computed in a very nice way, and the reason is technical, and is that the object which is behind these guys is the quantum dilogarithm. And it's known that the Fadejev quantum dilogarithm simplifies enormously when the parameter is rational. This was shown very recently by Garufalidis and Kasayev, that essentially when the parameter of the quantum dilogarithm becomes rational, the quantum dilogarithm, which is a complicated function, collapses to something simpler. And this is actually the reason why, for these values of h bar, things become much simpler. Now, you can actually, just to show you that this can be computed very explicitly, I show you here some values for local P2. So, for example, when n equal 1 and h bar is equal to 2 pi, which I have 1/9, when h bar is equal to 4 pi and equal 2, you get a more complicated number, but it's still something that you can write down. And it's not a transcendental, it's not really very transcendental, you have a little bit of irrationality here, but it's essentially up to this square root of 3, these are rational numbers, and pi. Okay. Well, now, my main claim is the following. Let's think about this as a partition function, depending on n and h bar, and let's take its log to have the free energy. I claim that this guy gives a non-perturbed definition of the topological stream free energy in the conical frame. That's my main claim. So, if I give you the definition of non-perturbative definition, I have to make sure that this satisfies the criteria that I told you. Okay? Well, first of all, I need a dictionary relating the parameters here to the parameters in string theory. What are the parameters in string theory? Well, there are the string coupling constant and the conifold modulus, which corresponds, if you want, to the radius in an ADS compactification. Now, the dictionary is the following. The string coupling constant is the inverse of the Planck constant. So this is already very interesting because it's telling you something about this definition. It's telling you that this is a strong weak coupling definition. In the sense that when the quantum mechanical problem is weakly coupled, the string theory will be strongly coupled and vice versa. The second definition I need is the modulus of the string theory, the conifold modulus as a function of n and h bar. And this is the dictionary. So lambda is actually the tough parameter for a theory with rank n and coupling constant 1 over h bar. Okay. Now, does this non-perturbative definition agree with our requirements? Well, the first requirement is that this guy is well-defined. But this is exactly what we have shown, we have proved. We have proved that the operators are trace class, so all these spectral traces are well-defined for any positive integer n and any real and positive h bar. So this is a well-defined object. Now, the second thing we have to check is the asymptotic property, that this object has an asymptotic expansion which reproduces the topological string unit expansion and nothing else. And the asymptotic you have to consider is the standard top limit. So this is very much in the spirit of ADS-CFT dualities. So you take n to infinity, you will take h bar to infinity because you want gs going to zero, and such that the top coupling is fixed. And then we conjecture that the asymptotic expansion of this guy is exactly giving you the genus expansion of the topological string at the conifold frame. Now, this is the part of my proposal which is conjectural. So, of course, you know, this is a conjecture, but conjectures, if they are well posed, can be checked. And actually, this asymptotic expansion has been checked in enormous detail. There are all kinds of checks. For example, there is a very nice check, which is really a direct check, which is just take, you know, shut up and compute, as Feynman used to say. You just take this guy and you span it, right? And you find the expansion. And the reason you can do this is that, as I said, you can write these kernels very explicitly. So you can sometimes write formulae for these Zs as matrix integrals. And then what you find is that this expansion is just the toughest expansion of the matrix integral. It's a matrix integral whose integrand involves the quantum dilogarithm of Padejev in a very crucial way. Now, when you actually expand this matrix integral, you can check this really analytically, coefficient by coefficient. And this is something that we did with my student Saul Zakani. And then we really check it, you know. Of course, it's a check. We cannot prove this for all genera and so on, but we can check that this is exactly as predicted. I will give you some additional indirect evidence for this in the talk, that actually this guy has as an asymptotic expansion this topological string genus free energies in the conifold frame. Okay, now we can address the issue of the discreteness of n. Okay, this is always like a problem for all these large n dualities with case theories, because n is discrete or n is continuous, what is n, and so on. Now, as I was mentioning before, you know, here, when I do in this dictionary, you see n is an integer, and so you see that I cannot cover arbitrary real gs and arbitrary real lambda by using just an integer n. Okay, so you can ask, okay, what happens with asymptotics with n is not an integer and so on. Well, in this case, we are very lucky because we have even a stronger conjecture that gives an exact formula for this fermionic spectral trace in terms of a function that can be computed from the BPS invariance of the Calabi-Yau X. I don't have time, unfortunately, to explain you this formula in detail. I think Alba, in her talk in the afternoon, will explain you a little bit more about this. But I only want to say that this is an exact formula. It's not an asymptotic formula, it's an exact formula. And the asymptotics that I was presenting before follows from this stronger conjecture. Now, the nice thing about this conjecture is that it expresses the fermionic spectral trace and some sort of Laplace transform of this function here. And you can actually see that if this formula is true, then you can use it to extend analytically this fermionic spectral trace to an entire function of the complex n-plane. So, So this our conjecture not only reproduces the values of these Fermilab spectral traces, but actually interpolates on the full complex plane. So in a sense, there is no problem with n being an integer because we can extend it to a function in the complex plane. So you know this is something that you can do if you assume this conjecture. But if this conjecture is true, this means something very interesting. It means that these Fermilab spectral traces are actually entire functions of the variable n. And this is not so crazy because this is exactly what you do with the spectral zeta function. The spectral zeta function, you define it for some values you take the sum of the spectrum like this. So maybe let me write this. So you have something like this, right? Assuming some simple, and then you know when s is equal to an integer L, this is precisely the trace of rho to the L that I was defining before. But you know that this function can be sometimes extended to the full complex plane with some singularities and so on. What I'm saying is something very similar. I'm saying that this fermionic spectral trace, which is a spectral trace after all, can be extended to be a function defined on the full complex plane.
And usually the zeta function satisfies a functional equation.
Yes. There are functional equations that you can write, say, for this. Not actually for this guy it's not so well, but for the generating functional, which is the Fredholm determinant. The Fredholm determinant satisfies some difference equations that you can use sometimes. But you know this is not so important for us because we can actually write them exactly with this conjecture. So in a paper we wrote with Alban Jasniewski, we explored some of these functional equations for the Fredholm determinant, but we didn't really pursue very much this direction. Okay. So this is my non-perturbative definition. It satisfies the criteria I proposed myself at the very beginning of my talk. There is still a conjectural part, which is that the asymptotics is actually the topological stream, but we have checked it and we have no doubt that this works. And now what I want to do is to make contact with something much more traditional, which is the theory of Borel resummation, and which has been now revamped as the theory of resurgence. Okay. And so, how would you pose this connection? Well, let's go back to my problem of the quartic oscillator. Okay, I gave you this perturbative series at the very beginning, but then you know if you are not you don't like to work very hard on spectral theory, you say, well, look, I mean, this series, I can just do some sort of resummation to try to get the exact energy levels, right? And, you know, people in physics have developed resummation techniques that, given a perturbative series, you can resum it in a clever way because this series is divergent, so you cannot resum it in a trivial way, but there are clever ways maybe to resum it. So I get a number at the end of the day. And this is going to be my non-perturbative number, okay? So these techniques go by the name of Borel resummation or the theory of resurgence and so on. And now, since I have proposed to you a non-perturbative definition of topological stream free energies, you know, you can ask, okay, how this is connected to the theory of Borel resummation? Because after all, you know, in many cases you can do these resummations. What's the relationship between these two things? So as I said, there is a traditional way to produce well-defined quantities from factorially divergent series, and this is called the theory of Borel resummation. So how does this work in a cartoonish way? Imagine that I give you a formal power series in some variable g such that the coefficients an diverge factorially. This means that the leading order of an is n factorial, and then you have a subleading exponential growth characterizing these coefficients. So, of course, this series does not converge because an grows like n factorial. So a very easy way to kind of cut this divergence is that divide by n factorial. And this is what the Borel transform does. The Borel transform takes this formal power series and gives me another formal power series, which is obtained by dividing an by n factorial. Now, typically, the series that you're taking this way has a finite radius of convergence around the origin. And now what you can try to do is this function, which is well-defined in a neighborhood of the origin, try to analytically extend it to the positive real axis and do a Laplace transform in this way. So you take this function, you multiply zeta by z, you do a Laplace transform, and then you get a function of z. Now this function, if it exists, is very easy to see that this is asymptotic expansion is the original series that you started with. So this is a fantastic machine which turns asymptotic expansions into well-defined functions, provided some conditions are fulfilled. Now, I gave you a very sketchy story of how this works. If you want to know more details, you can learn them in my book. So let me take this opportunity to make some publicity of my recent book, where all this is explained with examples and so on. Okay? So this procedure does not always make sense, because typically, when you do this resummation, when you do this Borel transform, the analytic structure of this guy involves some singularities. Now, if the singularities are not in the positive real axis, which is where you do the Laplace transform, everything is more or less okay. But if you have a singularity in the positive real axis, then the whole procedure is obstructed, and you say that the series is not Borel summable. Okay? Now, in practice, if I give you a crazy series, how do you do this? Well, you have to rely on numerics very often. So you have to check the absence of singularities and perform the resummation. But usually, you know, if you are lucky, you can see, for example, that no singularities will accumulate in the positive real axis, or you will see them, and so on. So many of these things can be checked numerically. Now, once you know that there is this procedure to make sense of non-perturbative series, of perturbative series, as the series, the question now is the following. Imagine that I have a quantum theory, and I have one of these divergent series. Okay. Now, imagine that I have given you a non-perturbative definition of what this perturbative series stands for. For example, in the case of the quartic oscillator, I gave you a formal power series, and I also gave you the non-perturbative definition based on spectral theory, which is the ground state of this potential. How are these two things related? How is the Borel resummation of this formal perturbative series related to the non-perturbative definition that I gave you? Are these equal? Are they different? This is a classical question in the theory of Borel resummation. Because Borel resummation, if the series is Borel summable, always gives you some number. The question is, this number is the one that you want. Maybe it's not the one that you want. And many of the developments of the theory of Borel resummation are actually based on giving you conditions for these things to work. Okay? Now, if the series is Borel summable, then if all this procedure of Borel resummation can be actually be done without obstructions, then you know then you get a number. And the question is, how is this number then related to original quantity? Now, in the case of the quartic oscillator, it was an important result in mathematical physics in the 70s that these two numbers agree. The Borel resummation, first of all, the series that you obtain for the ground state theorem is Borel summable. And the resummation, the Borel resummation of this function gives you a well-defined function of the coupling, and it turns out to be exactly equal to the ground state energy that you find using operator theory. So this was very good. This is a classical result which tells you, okay, in the quartic oscillator you don't have to worry. Having the perturbative series and having the exact answer, the non-perturbative definition is more or less the same, because there is no extra stuff. You do Borel resummation and you recover your original quantity. But, you know, this is not the rule. It might happen that the series is Borel summable, and still Borel resummation does not give you the quantity you want. And this sounds like a surprise for many people, because usually you think that for these things not to work, you have to have a series which is not Borel summable. But it was already realized by Balian, Parisi, and Bogos some time ago, and then rediscovered in a sense by Alba, myself, and Sabols in some more modern examples, that this is not always the case. You can have a series which is Borel summable, and still this Borel resummation does not recover the original quantity. And we gave some criteria for when this happens and so on. Now, in some cases, it's even worse. The series is not even Borel summable, so what do you do? If you have, for example, singularities on the positive real axis, you cannot really define the Laplace transform, and then things do not work. And this is actually, in a sense, the default situation in physics. For example, you take the double well potential in quantum mechanics, and you compute the perturbative series. Well, it's not Borel summable. You cannot go through all this procedure in a naive way. You have to do something else. So what you have to do when this is the case, or this is the case? Well, you need additional information. It's clear that the exact answer cannot be given just in terms of the perturbative series. You need something else. And this is what in physics we call a non-perturbative effect. Yes, this is the quartic oscillator in quantum mechanics. The quartic oscillator, but the pure quartic oscillator. In the pure quartic oscillator, it happens that...
Sorry, but I thought the Borel summation by definition should be produced asymptotically expanded.
No, it's not true. No. What I'm saying is that the Borel summation, this is why this was a surprise. Usually people say, the series is Borel summable and done. No, it's not true. It's not true. And this guy saw it in a quantum mechanical example, and we actually, this is going to be the situation in topological string theory, and it was the situation in the 1 over n expansion. So, and this is because, this is a very subtle phenomenon, because it's associated to the appearance of complex instantons, instantons with complex action. When the instantons have complex action, you have a singularity in the Borel plane, which is not in the positive real axis, but they still can contribute to the as a non-perturbative effect. So it's a very subtle thing, but it happens. So what is a non-perturbative effect? Well, this is, again, it's also one of these words that is used all the time. But fortunately, we have a kind of more formal framework to understand this, which is the theory of transseries. Now, very roughly, I cannot go into all these details because this involves all this theory of resonance and so on, but very roughly, what happens is the following. In a quantum theory, if you perturb around the trivial vacuum, around the trivial saddle point of the path integral, you find the standard perturbative series. If you do the perturbative expansion around a non-trivial saddle or an instanton, you find a transseries. No? So a transseries is just a formal sum of formal series. So you start with the perturbative series, which is the expansion on the trivial saddle, and now you do a perturbation around non-trivial saddle. A non-trivial saddle will have a non-trivial action, which appears typically as e to the minus a over g, where g is the coupling constant. And then when you do loops around the instanton, you will get another formal series, in the coupling constant g. And then what you do to form a transseries, you add this with the series that you find after expanding around a one instanton, but you can't have multi-instantons in the theory, so you have to add them as well, and so on. And then the instanton contribution is multiplied by a parameter, which actually is ambiguous. And so we will leave it as a parameter. And the reason why it's ambiguous is because, as I said, all these series are formal, right? So you don't really make sense of these series unless you do something very concrete. And this means that there will be always a parameter reflecting this ambiguity from the fact that these series are purely formal. Now, it turns out that you can actually, again, I'm skipping here many things, but it turns out that even when the theory is not Borel summable, if you include the transseries, there is a formal procedure to do Borel resummation, even taking into account the singularities, which is called sometimes Borel-Eckel resummation. And essentially what happens is that instead of doing the integral around the positive real axis, you go around the singularities through an appropriate path in the complex plane, and then you get something which is ambiguous and complex. But this is going to be cured by the transseries effect. Okay, it's a complicated theory. I'm not going to get into the details. But at the end of the day, the theory of Borel-Eckel tells me that if I give you a perturbative series plus all these instanton corrections, I can compute numbers by doing Borel-Eckel resummation, but these numbers will depend on parameters, and these parameters are associated to the instantons that appear in the theory. Okay, so if you want to pay the price of having an ambiguity in your theory, you can do this instanton stuff. So sometimes people say that resurgence techniques give you a non-perturbative definition of the theory. This is false. Okay, never buy this. Okay, because resurgence always comes with parameters. So it's not true that you get an ambiguous answer. You get ambiguous answers, and actually this was, here in Italy, I want to say that many of these things were discovered by Parisi while studying, Renormalon effects in QCD and so on. He realized very quickly that the coefficient appearing in front of a non-perturbative effect in a quantum theory is intrinsically ambiguous. So you cannot fix it unless you give me some extra information. So these techniques of Borel resummation give me multi-parameter families of non-perturbative objects, but they are not fully defined.
Yes. If you have a totality definition of a system, then whatever quantity you want to compute is not ambiguous, right?
No, just that's the thing.
What you're saying is that when you expand in a series, then there's...
Exactly. So what I'm saying is, for example, here in the double-well potential, if you do Borel-Eckel resummation, there will be an ambiguity. How do you fix this ambiguity? By going back to your non-perturbative definition of what is a ground state energy using operator theory. I mean, Schrödinger theory tells you that in this system there is a single ground state energy, right? Because this is a confining potential, so it's going to have a ground state energy. Now, if you want to calculate this ground state energy using this technique, oops, you will have an ambiguity here, and this you will have to fix at the end of the day, okay? You will have to fix by comparing to non-perturbative definition. So that's why Resorgis doesn't give you non-ambiguous non-perturbative definitions. It encodes the ambiguities in non-perturbative definition in a finite set of numbers, okay? But it's still ambiguous. Okay, so now we can ask again, now that we have this enlarged framework, can we reconstruct a non-perturbative function from a trans-series, not just the perturbative series, but the series plus all instantons corrections. And this is what I'm going to call the semi-classical decoding conjecture. It's not always the case that you can do it. So the semi-classical decoding conjecture says that non-perturbative functions in quantum theory can be written as the Borel-Eckel resummation of a trans-series. And this is true in quantum mechanics in many examples, in one-dimensional quantum mechanics. It's true in some simple systems, in some simple quantum field theories in long dimensions or topological of some sort, or for example, in supersymmetric systems, but it's probably not true in Jan-Mills theory in infinite volume. So you cannot decode the ground state properties of Jan-Mills theory using semi-classical objects, which is the intuition which is behind this semi-classical decoding conjecture, okay? Okay, so this was a detour through resurgence theory, a little bit quick. So let me go back to my original problem with non-perturbative topological strings. So I have given you this non-perturbative definition of topological strings. Now the question is the semi-classical decoding conjecture true for this? Can I decode this non-perturbative definition in terms of some perturbative series plus some instanton corrections? Now the first thing to do, if you want to do this, is to first of all, you have to see your perturbative series is Borel-summable or not. That's the first thing. Because if it's Borel-summable, then maybe life is simple, and just by doing Borel resummation, you are done. Okay? So this is the first thing you have to do. And this is something that we could have done long ago. We could have long ago looked at all these genus G-free energies of topological string theory and ask if the theory is Borel-summable or not. And in the following, just for concreteness, I will focus on local P2. Now, it turns out that the perturbative genus expansion is Borel-summable for almost all real and positive values of lambda. The way to you do it is to actually compute this Borel transform numerically and see if there are poles on the positive real axis, stable poles. So you see that here, after 114 genera analyzed, we don't have any obstruction on the positive real axis. We see that we have poles in the complex plane and the imaginary line. So these are sources for non-perturbative effects, but they are not on the positive real axis. So you can do a standard Borel resummation of the topological string. You can just take your genus expansion in the conical frame, as, for example, Albrecht computed like a few years ago, and then you push the computer and then try to do Borel resummation. So you can get numerical answers for this. Okay? So how do they compare with the non-perturbative definition I gave you? And this is really, here we are doing really precision numerics of non-perturbative topological string. We're really able to get to numbers. And that's why I think this proposal is very concrete. Okay.
For this, is there a corresponding semi-classical conformation?
Yes, actually, for example, these poles that I put here with lines, with these circles, these are the value of this pulse function of lambda is a period of the Calabi-Yau.
Ah, I see.
And this is a nice, interesting property that the singularities in the Borel plane seem to be always combinations of the periods of the Calabi-Yau. So, for example, this is one of the periods, this is another one, and then you have shifts in 4 pi square, you see? So there is a very nice structure which we still don't fully understand it, but yeah, in a sense, if you want, periods measure the mass of D-brains. So in a sense, these axions are masses of D-brains, of topological D-brains, which are supposedly contributing to a non-perturbative structure. I will come back to this at the end of the talk.
Does it just look like that, or is there symmetry in the x and y axis if you reflect it?
Sorry? This is the complex lambda plane. Okay.
Right. And there's symmetry in x and y axis?
So there is, and this is, for example, this is, for example, you see that you have lambda and then you have the complex conjugate, right? You have lambda minus lambda and then you have the complex conjugate. And this is because when lambda is real, the perturbative series is real. And then if you have a complex object, you have to have its conjugate. And also because the power series is in even powers of G string, you will have to have plus lambda and minus lambda, so minus as plus a singularity and minus a singularity. So all these symmetries are actually a consequence of the structure, the reality and parity structure of the perturbative series, okay? Okay, oops. Okay, so let's do the spelling. Let me take the Borel resummation of the perturbative series when n is equal to 2 and h is equal to 4 pi. I'm doing this because this I can compute with my non-perturbative definition. So what I get is this number here, and all these digits here are stable digits. Okay, so this I could have done like many years ago. Now, our non-perturbative definition gives, remember I was quoting this number for you, 5 over 324 minus 1 over square root of 3 times p times 12. And this number, if you write it in digits, is this one. So the first thing you notice is that these numbers are incredibly close. And this is, again, another way of seeing that our non-perturbative definition is actually on the right track, in the sense that it's almost the Borel resummation of the original series. So a few years ago, we could have done this calculation. We would have obtained this number here. And what is amazing is that now we have an approximation to this number, which is this spectral trace. So, you know, this spectral theory knows something of the topological string. And this is actually reflecting that our conjecture is true, reflecting that the fact that our conjecture predicts that the asymptotic expansion of these numbers has to be the perturbative genus expansion of the topological string. And this is one way of seeing it. So these numbers are incredibly close, but they are not exactly the same. So we conclude that we are in the second case I was presenting you before. The theory is Borel summable, but the Borel resummation does not reproduce this, the Borel resummation does not reproduce our non-perturbative definition. And this we have seen before in this example of Valian, Parisian, Boros, but in a closer example, it was shown by Alba, Sabolsakani, and myself, that this is exactly what happens if you look at the 1 over n expansion of the ABJM matrix model. In ABJM matrix model, you can compute the matrix model for finite values of n, you can compute the 1 over n expansion, and it's Borel summable, so you can compare both of them. And you see that there is a mismatch. And this is a mismatch due to the fact that the perturbative 1 over n expansion is not including all non-perturbative effects. And this is exactly the same. Our non-perturbative definition is not exactly agreeing with this Borel resummation because we are missing non-perturbative effects here. Now, you can do this experiment for many values of lambda. The agreement is actually quite amazing. So here I take h bar equal to 4 pi and vary n. So you see, I can do integer values of n, and I can do also non-integer values of n, assuming using this formula that I was presenting you before. So you see the black line is the Borel resummation, and the dots are the values that we obtain from the spectral theory, from quantum mechanical operator coming from the mirror record. So you see, the difference is not visible to the naked eye. So all this Borel resummation is always very close to the non-perturbative definition we get. Okay? And this is exactly what you should expect from our conjecture. Because if our conjecture is true, the Borel resummation of the perturbative series and our non-perturbative definition should only differ in exponentially small effects, in effects which are not visible in an asymptotic expansion. Now, the question is, can we compute this effect explicitly? Can we actually find a trans-series such that this Borel-Lecal resummation gives back the exact answer? And of course, this is a very complicated problem in string theory, because in string theory, already computing, you know, the perturbative effects, the perturbative series is very hard. Computing non-perturbative effects in string theory is even not a well-defined problem, because you don't have a string field theory from which you can define this, right? So how can you do this in non-perturbative, in topological strings? How can you compute non-perturbative effects? Well, the inspiration here comes from the theory of matrix models. Now, in the theory of matrix models, you know, in the theory of matrix models, you have the matrix integral, and the matrix integral, in principle, you can compute instanton effects from the matrix integral. But in the theory of matrix models, you also have recursion relations, and then I come back to your observation. There are recursion relations that determine the perturbative series, and very typically, you can promote these recursion relations to non-perturbative recursion relations that also compute exponentially small quantities. And we have a recursion relations for the genus G free energies, and these are the holomorphic anomaly equations of Bersaski, Chekhov, Gurianov. So This was an idea proposed by Ricardo Couso Santamaria, Ricardo Schiappa and collaborators, which is, okay, and take VCOV, which is a recursion relation for the perturbative Fourieris, and now assuming that instead of plugging in this recursion just the perturbative series, I'm going to plug also a non-perturbative effect like this. And then I will try to solve for this. Of course, you know, there will be all holomorphic ambiguities and so on. You have to fix them and so on. But, and now I'm going to be a little bit fast because the technical details are actually complicated. But at the end of the day, you can solve for these non-perturbative corrections using VCOV in terms of perturbative topological data. And assuming that the instanton axioms, this is an assumption, and assuming that the instanton axioms are given by periods of the Calabi-Yau. This is a checkable assumption because everything that you actually write down here can be tested through the well-known mechanism of large-order behavioral perturbation theory. Bender and Wu found that whenever you have non-perturbative correction and non-perturbative transseries effect in your theory, every information here, except for this coefficient which is ambiguous, can be read from the large-order behavior of perturbation theory, right? And this is something that is very important. So the fact that these instanton axioms are periods of the Calabi-Yau can be checked against the large-order behavior of these series. Okay, so all these things are testable. And then, you know, I'm skipping for you the details, so let me just show you one number to show you that this more or less works. So what we did at the end of the day was to include the one instanton correction given by this procedure. We put a fixed parameter C, which we fixed as actually a quite simple value of C. So it turns out to depend on N, but it's just this thing here. So this is the value of C that we, that this is a value that has to be fixed experimentally. We don't have any clue why this works, but this is the universal value we use. And then you see that now, remember, this was the Borel resummation of the perturbative series. We match some digits. This is the exact answer. And now, if we add the one instanton correction, we improve this precision to all the precision that is given by a one instanton correction. Of course, if you want to improve even more this, you have to use two instanton corrections and so on. So, of course, we did this for many, many values of lambda, and in all cases it works. So this is evidence that our non-perturbative completion, which is a well-defined non-perturbative definition of topological string theory, not only is a well-defined definition, but it can also decode the semi-classical in terms of a trans series. So at the end of the day, we have provided essentially everything we needed. We have provided a non-perturbative definition. This non-perturbative definition contains information about the perturbative series, but it also contains non-perturbative sectors which can be formally computed through a modification of the holomorphic anomaly equations. And of course, the question now that is mainly open is, how would you interpret these non-perturbative effects? I mean, maybe they are due to topological D-brains. They look like they are due to topological D-brains. But of course, it's very hard to define a first principle calculus of topological D-brains and topological string theory. So that's why we use the VCOV holomorphic anomaly equations as a way to get this indirectly. Okay, let me conclude here. So more or less in time, I hope. You're not, well, 5 minutes later. So we have given a rigorous and concrete non-perturbative definition of topological string theory. That's, for me, the most important result. And this definition is interesting because, you know, the question here is not who gives a non-perturbative definition. It's very easy to give non-perturbative definitions just by doing a resummation, for example. The interesting thing of our definition is it's non-trivial. It relates the topological string theory to spectral theory. And we also have shown that although this definition is highly non-trivial, it can be decoded through the standard theory of resurgence in terms of perturbative series plus trans series, including instanton effects, and so on. Now, there are many questions that you can ask. For example, as I was mentioning, this quantity can be written as a matrix model. So in principle, you could think that the instanton effects can be computed directly from this matrix model. But this is a very tricky calculation because this matrix model involves this Fadejev quantum dilogue, and so it's a complicated thing. Now, as I said, you know, there might be other non-perturbative definitions. I mean, we are not claiming that this is the best one. It's definitely a one non-perturbative definition. It's interesting because it makes this connection to spectral theory. And it has given many, many interesting results already on Calabi-Yau's. Even sometimes, this non-perturbative definition gives perturbative information that was not known before. For example, it gives you for free the values of the periods at the conifold point, which is a well-known problem in number theoretical properties of Calabi-Yau's that can be solved here with operator theory. So we can use operator theory to solve a classical problem of special geometry of Calabi-Yau's. Of course, you know, the main thing is how would you prove this correspondence? How would you prove this connection between spectral theory and topological strings? Because, you know, my talk was based on one conjecture, which is that the asymptotic expansion of these objects is the standard topological string. This is part of the conjectures we have, and there is a very interesting particular case of this conjecture, which was proved recently here at Trieste by Giulio, Alessandro, and Alba. And Alba is going to talk about this in the afternoon session. And of course, we would like to have a general proof. And this is really a well-defined mathematical problem. We are making a statement of the spectral theory of some operators, and we are relating this to a well-defined enumerative theory of Calabi-Yau. So these two things are deeply related, and I think this is a very interesting correspondence, and I hope mathematicians will also do some work on this, and maybe given up, they will be giving us a proof in the near future. Thank you.